In this module, we're going to learn about spent nuclear fuel safeguards. So then the first question is, what is spent nuclear fuel? The U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission, or NRC, defines spent nuclear fuel as nuclear fuel elements that have been used at nuclear reactors but that are no longer capable of economically sustaining a nuclear reaction. However, a more general or common definition is any nuclear fuel that's been irradiated in a nuclear reactor and subsequently removed. All right, so let's start with some general physical characteristics of nuclear fuel assemblies. We'll start with a pressurized water reactor, or PWR, fuel assembly. And on the bottom here, we see an illustration of a PWR assembly with all the subcomponents that are in it. On the very bottom, in the right corner, we start with a fuel pellet, and that is placed in a fuel rod. And then the fuel rods are arranged in a square lattice that go into the fuel assembly. You also see in the center there the control rods that are centrally located within the fuel assembly. That is actually a control rod assembly cluster, that manifold on the top that slides down the center of the different positions of the fuel assembly. And then in the upper corner there, you have an actual picture of a fuel assembly, a PWR fuel assembly. Next, we'll take a look at a boiling water reactor fuel assembly, or BWR assembly. Here we have an illustration with some of the central rods moved out, so you can see within. You see several grid plates and the fuel rods moving down. There are no control or guide rods within these BWR assemblies. Those are control in a BWR is done with an external kind of control rod or a cruciform control assembly that goes between the fuel assemblies. The next image is a Russian fuel assembly known as the VVR. VVR stands for water-water energetic reaction. That has to do with water moderation and water cooling of a nuclear reactor. And here you can see the hexagonal fuel design with the fuel pins and then the guide tubes kind of in the central area there. All right, so now let's take a look at some more of the specific characteristics, physical characteristics of nuclear fuel assemblies. In the table on the left, we have in the first column the physical characteristic of interest, and then in the next columns are for a PWR, a BWR, and a fast breeder reactor, which was not pictured on the previous slide. The table lists properties of the cladding, also the initial enrichment, the fuel type, as well as the lattice array arrangement and how many fuel rods are in each assembly. On the right there, we have illustrations of the lattice arrays. On the top is a PWR. You can see that it's about 21.5 centimeters on each side. It also lists the fuel rod positions and the guide tube locations. In the BWR below that illustration, you can see that a BWR is about 13.5 centimeters on each side. And then for the fast breeder reactor is the hexagonal lattice array, and that's about 10.8 centimeters across. So next, let's talk about spent nuclear fuel operation characteristics. And what we'll go through is the irradiation history, spent fuel burnup, initial enrichment, and the cooling time. All factor into the operation characteristics of a spent nuclear fuel assembly. So what happens to a fuel assembly during reactor operation? What we have in front of us is a grid layout of a nuclear reactor core. To begin reactor operation, fuel assemblies are loaded at each one of the square positions within the core, and then the reactor is started. And you'll notice on this map as the reactor is operated, the different colors from blue to red, and red indicates more power, more neutrons being generated, whereas a blue has less power and less neutrons being created. So during the course of reactor operation, the reactor's turned on, and the assemblies produce power and neutrons, and then it's turned off after typically what you call a cycle of irradiation. Then the fuel assemblies are lifted out and rearranged to optimize performance, put back in, and irradiation started again for another cycle. Then perhaps that cycle ends, the fuel assemblies come out of the reactor again, they're rearranged one more time, and get another cycle of irradiation. And you'll notice that during the operation, different positions, different fuel assembly positions experience greater power than others. So the power experienced by a fuel assembly isn't necessarily constant between different cycles. It can go up. Some assemblies get a much higher irradiation with higher power and more neutrons produced, while others experience less power produced during the course of operation. So the operational parameters that we're going to discuss describe these kind of different what you call irradiation histories that a fuel assembly experiences. So irradiation history is a record of the specific power or energy released from nuclear fuel as a function of time. So on this slide, we have two figures describing different irradiation histories. On the left, we have a single cycle with constant power. That has a specific power of 35 watts per gram, noted here, and it irradiates for 1,000 days. The second figure shows a three-cycle constant power per cycle irradiation history. The first and third cycles both have a specific power of 70 watts per gram, while the second cycle has a specific power of 17.5 watts per gram. We've also inserted two 20-day shutdowns in between each cycle. Now, these are just examples. Irradiation histories for actual nuclear fuel assemblies may be more complicated than this. They may increase or not be constant during the individual cycle. So these are just examples that kind of illustrate the concept of irradiation history. Next concept we'll talk about is burnup. So irradiation history and burnup are related. Burnup is actually the total energy extracted from the nuclear fuel. So this is simply just the integral of the irradiation history, which is just the area under the curve here. Of course, since that curve is just a simple rectangle, we know that that is just the length of the rectangle, which is 1,000 days times the height, which is 35 watts per gram. And that'll equal 35,000 megawatt days per metric ton uranium, which is the standard unit measure of burnup. And then if we take a look at a second irradiation history, we have 1,200 days and 50 watts per gram. So multiply those together and we get a burnup of 60,000 megawatt days per metric ton uranium. So one thing we should point out is that burnup is not necessarily unique to a specific irradiation history. So on the left, we have two figures here containing different irradiation histories. The first case there in the blue is from before. That's our 35 watts per gram specific power for 1,000 days. The green is twice that at 70 watts per gram for 500 days. And the pink there is half the case one specific power, 17.5 watts per gram for 2,000 days. And then on the bottom figure, we have a fourth case, and that operates at 35 watts per gram for total irradiation of 1,000 days, but we also inserted two 20-day shutdowns in between there. And what you see, though, when you look at the burnup, is that the burnup for these different radiation histories are all the same. We point out that the units on this burnup figure are different. They're now gigawatt days per metric ton. You'll see it reported as both the gigawatt days per metric ton and megawatt days per metric ton, as shown in the previous figure. But again, burnup is not necessarily unique for these four irradiation histories, which are all different. They all have the same burnup. So another thing we want to consider for operational characteristics is the initial enrichment. Now, we also talked about initial enrichment during the physical characteristics of fresh fuel assemblies, but it also impacts the operation. Specifically, it impacts the potential final burnup. Basically, the more FISOC content, whether that's U-235 or plutonium-239 for a MOX fuel assembly, mixed oxide fuel assembly, meaning both uranium and plutonium are in the fuel assembly to begin, the more fissile content that you have, the more burnup you can, higher burnup you can operate to, and more energy you can get out of the fuel. So initial enrichment is an important thing to consider for the operational characteristics of a spent fuel assembly. And finally, we want to talk about cooling time. And cooling time is simply the amount of time after the final irradiation of the spent fuel assembly. So here we have a figure of the irradiation history. We see that it was operated at 35 watts per gram with two shutdowns during operation. And then after the final irradiation begins the cooling time. They're noted by the blue line. Typically the spent fuel just sits in the spent fuel pool where it is allowed to cool, but this may also include time that the spent fuel assembly has been placed into dry storage.